Lord be with you. You know, you can tell it's a nice day outside because everybody came to church this morning with a whole lot of energy, if you haven't figured that out. And it is a beautiful, beautiful morning. Welcome to our worship service this Sunday morning. I'd like to begin with just a few announcements very quickly. The first thing I'm going to do, so I don't forget, is I'm going to turn over the announcements to Jack Carlson. He has an announcement that he'd like to make, I believe, on Northwood Share. Thanks, Jack. Let's see. Where else should we start? We have also coming up, it's in your bulletin as well, but I like to continue to mention this, that you also reach out to people within the community, not necessarily members of Shepherd of the Lakes, but we are approaching All Saints Sunday. That is actually 2 weeks away from today, where we remember, okay, those we have lost in this year, and we also remember those that we've just still miss, that we have lost in the past. We try not to make it specific to the calendar year here. So I'd like you to be thinking about who you would like to have remembered, lift up names that day. There is a sign-up sheet out there for people that if you're not going to be here, we can put a name on there. Otherwise, if you'd like it more confidential, just get those names either to Jean, Sharon, or myself. But we will celebrate them. And we will lift their names up on All Saints Day. On that same note, we had a tragic loss here in the congregation this week as well. Keeping with my tradition of not using last names, we need to pray today for Kevin and for Teresa. And we lost Kevin this week very, very suddenly. Our church treasurer is on the way in. It's not out there right now, but there will be a card laying on the table as you leave the worship service today. It will be there, and I encourage you to sign that card in support of the family for the loss of Kevin. And the last thing I think that's important to Thanksgiving is approaching. I don't know where this year went, but it's really moving along quite quickly, and we are preparing for our Thanksgiving Day community dinner. Okay, so everything is in the process. Everything is moving along well, but I just want you to know that we will be celebrating Thanksgiving Day here for those that just want to come. And, of course, it's going to all be there for you, and there will be more details that will be coming up as we get closer. There will be flyers that will be put out for it. We'll have our sign changed. We'll have it on Facebook. We will be letting people know that we will be gathering on Thanksgiving Day. But also wanted to let you know as well that you can mention it to people as you meet them, as you see need as well. And also remember, too, that we try to have enough people with vehicles that if we have someone, a shut-in, someone that doesn't drive, someone that we can share a meal with that day, we'll find a way to get it there. So, again, our Thanksgiving Day community dinner is, for all practical purposes, back in full swing. That's the last announcement I have for this morning. I just simply like to say, as far as your service is concerned, if you're worshiping with us today, if you're visiting, everything that you need for your service you were given as you entered the narthex, it's there all in order. And as our tradition is, we commune whenever we gather, and you are welcome to the Lord's table here. If it is your wish to commune, simply come forward. You will receive the host from me, and then moving left or right, as we will commune one half of the church at a time, you simply dip the host into the wine that's in the chalice or grape juice, which is in the small section of the chalice, and or you can receive the wine or grape juice by individual glass. And if you receive by individual glass, you'll notice on each side of the sanctuary there's a waste bin for your glass. But the emphasis is when we gather, we share the Lord's Supper. When we gather, all are welcome to the Lord's table. So that's all the announcements that I have today. So let us prepare our hearts and our minds to worship a gracious and loving God. I invite you to join with me in the invocation and confession and forgiveness. We begin our worship this day in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin and receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our gathering song today, How Small Our Span of Life, ELW 636. Today we will sing verses 1 through 3, and I invite you to stand as you are comfortable. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Lord be with you. Please join me in the prayer. Holy God, our righteous judge, daily your mercy surprises us with everlasting forgiveness. Strengthen our hope in you and grant that all the peoples of the earth may find their glory in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Our first reading is from the 14th chapter of Jeremiah. Although our iniquities testify against us, act, O Lord, for your name's sake. Our apostasies indeed are many, and we have sinned against you. O hope of Israel, its Savior in time of trouble, why should you be like a stranger in the land? Like a traveler turning aside for the night. Why should you be like someone confused, like a mighty warrior who cannot help? Yet you, O Lord, are in the midst of us, and we are called by your name. Do not forsake us. Thus says the Lord concerning his people, truly they have loved to wander. They have not restrained their feet. Therefore, the Lord does not accept them. Now he will remember their iniquity and punish their sins. O Lord, have you completely rejected Judah? Does your heart loathe Zion? Why have you struck us down so that there is no healing for us? We look for peace, but find no good, for a time of healing, but there is terror instead. We acknowledge our wickedness, O Lord, the iniquity of our ancestors, for we have sinned against you. Do not spurn us. For your name's sake, do not dishonor your glorious throne. Remember, and do not break your covenant with us. Can any idols of the nations bring rain? Or can the heavens give showers? Is it not you, O Lord our God, who we set our hope on you? For it is you who do all this. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We will read from Psalm 84 today. I need to alert you to, I think, a misprint in verse 6. Not the Balsam Valley, but the Barren Valley. I don't know if you can remember that, but try. Okay. From Psalm 84. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts. My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest where she may lay her young, by the side of your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God.
Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you.
Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way. Though we go through the barren valley, we have the peace of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water. They will climb from height to height, and the God of gods will be seen in Zion. Our second reading is from Paul's second letter to Timothy, chapter 4. And Paul says, as for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. At my first offense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed to all the Gentiles, so that all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able for the gospel acclamation.
Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus also told this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and regarded others with contempt. Two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, was praying this: God, I thank you that I am not like other people, thieves, rogues, adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, I give a tenth of all my income, but the tax collector standing far off would not even look up to heaven, but it was beating his breast saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you that this man went down to his home justified rather than the other. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humbled themselves will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray that the Holy Spirit will guide me in delivering this message so that it's acceptable and reflects God's will. Amen. Well, today's gospel message is a story about how God expects us to behave toward him and toward our neighbors. No matter how much wealth we have accumulated, how much property we own, how righteous we think we are, or how popular or successful we are, we owe it all to God. We are just stewards of God's creation and beneficiaries of his gifts and blessings. The Pharisee in this story brags about his righteousness and how he is so much better than others, including the repentant tax collector pleading for God's mercy. This Pharisee has probably memorized the Torah, like most of his fellow rabbis, and knows all of the Levitical laws. They follow the letter of the law, including daily prayer, fasting, and tithing. But they lack the gifts of the Spirit, such as kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, modesty, and love. Jesus tells us to love our neighbors as ourselves. This Pharisee looks down on others and exalts himself as better than others, including the tax collector. As another Bible story relates to us, let he who has no sin cast the first stone. This Pharisee is throwing stones and declaring that he is not a sinner like those others. He doesn't need a savior because he believes, due to his works, he can act as his own Lord and Savior. That's why the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and many other Jews didn't really understand the real reason why Jesus came down to earth. The Messiah to them was coming to deliver them from oppression and lead them to victory, not die for their sins. In their eyes, they were already righteous, following the law, at least as best they could. Jesus states at the end of the story, all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. The definition of exaltation is an excessive, intensified sense of power or importance. In this story, the Pharisee's self-image and his pride are unwarranted in God's eyes. In Proverbs 8:13, it's stated that God hates pride and arrogance. And there are about 200 Bible verses that mention pride. But it's never mentioned as a good thing. Almost every time pride is mentioned in the Bible, it's followed by its opposite, humility. 1 Peter 5:5 states that God opposes the proud, but promises grace to the humble. And in Proverbs 16:18, it states that pride goes before destruction, an arrogant spirit before a fall. Today, I'm going to relate two stories of how pride, arrogance, and personal exaltation can bring kings, kingdoms, and individual people down. My first story comes from the Old Testament. It starts around 720 BC and ends around 540 BC. That's moving forward in time, opposite, obviously. During this 180-year period in the Holy Land, four kingdoms would fall, and six kings would be humbled by God. The story begins in the northern kingdom of Israel, and King Hoshea, considered a wicked Hebrew king and the last king of the northern kingdom. Several prophets, including Micah, Hosea, and Isaiah, warned the king and the people of Israel that unless they repented, God's judgment would be executed on them as they were rebelling against God and they were worshiping idols at that time. In Micah 1:6, God says, "I will make Samaria a heap of rubble." Samaria was then the capital of the northern kingdom of Israel. In 721 BC, these prophecies came true as Israel fell to King Sennacherib and the Assyrians. And 10 of the 12 original Hebrew tribes were conquered, scattered, and lost forever. King Hoshea was captured and taken to Nineveh, the capital of Assyria, where he was imprisoned and died. Disobedience to God, arrogance, and exalting themselves brought the kingdom down. The Assyrians were just the vessel of God's judgment. Soon after, King Sennacherib and his massive Assyrian army turned their sights on Judah to the south. But the king of Judah, King Hezekiah, prayed to the Lord to deliver them from the Assyrians. God sent an angel, and in that one night killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers, virtually destroying the entire Assyrian army and sending their king back to Nineveh in disgrace, from which he and their kingdom would never recover. Remember Jonah preached repentance to the then king and people of Nineveh 50 or so years before? They had repented and trusted God at that time, but like the Israelites, after a generation or so, they had strayed and were also now being punished for their pride and worship of God, of other gods, and disobedience. So two kingdoms and two kings were deposed in that period around 700 BC. Around that time, King Hezekiah of Judah received two visitors, envoys from a faraway land. Hezekiah had just recovered from a serious life-threatening illness, and with the prophet Isaiah's prayer and godly support. Since his life was spared, Hezekiah promised his allegiance to God, and that he would, as stated in Isaiah 38:15, walk humbly for the rest of his life, serving God. But, wanting to impress his two visiting guests, Hezekiah boasted of his wealth and that of his kingdom. In Isaiah 39:2, it stated that he showed them everything, silver, gold, fine spices, olive oil, his entire armory, and everything among his treasures. There was nothing in his palace or in all of his kingdom that he did not show them, the Bible says. The envoys left. And soon afterwards, Isaiah came to him and asking about those two envoys. Hezekiah told him that they were from a distant land, Babylon, I think. Isaiah asked the king, "What did they see in your palace?" The king responded, "They saw everything in my palace. There is nothing in my palace that I did not show them." Then Isaiah spoke these prophetic words to King Hezekiah, and I'm going to read it directly from Scripture. "Hear the word of the Lord Almighty. The time will surely come when everything in your palace and all that your predecessors have stored up until this day will be carried off to Babylon. Nothing will be left, says the Lord. And And some of your descendants, your own flesh and blood, will be born to you, will be taken away, and they will become eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. Because of Hezekiah's boasting, Isaiah's amazing prophecy would come true some 130 years later when King Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian army conquered Judah, pillaged their treasures, and took captives, Daniel among others, and destroyed the temple in 586 BC. King Zedekiah, then king of Judah, and an evil king, would thereby be the last king of Judah. And the Babylonians were the instrument of God's justice for these remaining Hebrews who had gone astray. King Zedekiah's eyes were gouged out, and the last thing he witnessed was the execution of his entire family. He would later die in a Babylonian prison. So another kingdom, Judah, was brought down because of the pride and boasting of King Hezekiah and the arrogance and disobedience of King Zedekiah. If you're counting, that's now three kingdoms and four kings, all brought down for the same reason, exalting themselves and their wealth or power and not obeying or acknowledging God. Do you see a pattern developing here? Well, the rest of the story takes place in the book of Daniel, where Daniel, in exile in Babylon, earns the trust and favor of King Nebuchadnezzar, mostly due to Daniel's wisdom and his ability to interpret the king's dreams. However, this king, as others, lets his ego come before God as Daniel eventually interprets the king's last dream. Daniel tells the king that until he renounces his sins and acknowledges God, the God of the Hebrews, as the true and sovereign God, this dream means that you, king, will be driven away from your people and will live with the wild animals and eat grass like an ox. I'm sure the king laughed, but that happened soon afterwards. Well, after 7 years of grazing, the king finally repented, and in Daniel 4:37 he says, "Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and glorify the King of heaven, because everything is right, and all his ways are just, and those who walk in pride he is able to humble." In this case, Nebuchadnezzar repents and is restored to his throne. As another verse in Proverbs states, pride brings a person low, but with repentance, the lowly in spirit gain honor. So there's one last chapter to this story, and it involves Nebuchadnezzar's grandson, King Belshazzar. Again, a generation has passed, and lessons learned are again forgotten. About 30 years after Nebuchadnezzar's reign, his grandson, Belshazzar, decides to throw a big party and banquet. After several cocktails, the king decides to retrieve and use the gold and silver goblets taken from the temple in Jerusalem that his grandfather had safely and reverently stored in his palace. They partied hard, and the king and his nobles, his wives and concubines, stated in Daniel 5:4, drank the wine, and they praised the gods of gold and silver, bronze and iron. Then suddenly, the finger of a large human hand appeared and wrote something strange on the wall. The Bible states that the king's face turned pale, and his legs became weak, and his knees were knocking. At the advice of his grandmother, he summoned Daniel, now in his 80s, to interpret the writing on the wall. It was not good news for the king, as in Daniel's words, "You, king, unlike your grandfather Nebuchadnezzar, have not humbled yourself, but have set yourself up against the Lord of heaven. Your kingdom will end and will be given to the Medes and Persians." That very night, the king was slain, and Darius the Mede took over the kingdom. So as you can see, sometimes what goes around comes around, and as it is said, the writing is on the wall. What started by boasting of treasures 120 years earlier in Jerusalem ended with those treasures being flaunted in arrogance to God in Babylon. Four kingdoms, Assyria, Israel, Judah, and Babylon, all brought down by God because of pride, arrogance, and personal exaltation. This same story is repeated throughout history, starting in Egypt with the Exodus, continuing into Canaan, then Goliath and the Philistines, later the downfall of the Medes, the Persians, the Greeks, and the Romans, and so on to present day. In many ways, don't we here in the U.S. resemble those past kingdoms? Are we next? Don't know. To conclude, I have a short personal story to relate when I was in high school. I was a junior pitcher on a very good Middleton, Wisconsin high school baseball team. We were ranked as one of the best teams in the state in 1968. There was a Catholic high school in Madison, Edgewood, that was the number one ranked Catholic high school. We were both undefeated. This was to be the game of the year in Wisconsin high school baseball in 1968. The newspapers promoted the game for several days prior, and there were hundreds of fans who would attend the game. Well, I was slated to pitch the game, and I and my teammates were confident that we would beat Edgewood. They were the home team, and the game was tied 2-2 going into the bottom of the eighth inning, and this was in the extra innings. And I had to face the top of their order, all good hitters. I got the first two guys out, but then walked the number three hitter. He was fast, and he was a great base stealer. So I tried to pick him off first, but I threw the ball 2 feet over the head of my first baseman. The runner, being very fast, got all the way to third base. The next batter was the number one hitter in the Madison metro area, and I still remember his name. His name was Tom Fahey, and he was batting like 600, which meant he got a hit every other time at bat at least. I had got him out a couple of times before, so I was confident I could do it again. He smashed my first pitch to center field for a single, and the game-winning run scored from third base. Game over. I was devastated. All those eyes on me, the fans, the sports reporters, my teammates, my high school classmates, my friends, and my dad. I let everyone down. There was no one to blame but myself. I threw the ball away, and I also gave up the game-winning hit. Totally my doing. It was a long bus ride home and a long night. I remember sitting in our family room that night just staring at the wall for hours, and I couldn't sleep very well that night either. But you know what? The sun came up that next morning. My teammates and friends were still talking to me at school and encouraged me for the rest of the season. My dad even gave me a big hug and told me how proud he was of me. And that's a good use of the word proud or pride. We would later actually go on to win the conference and also took second in state. I pitched the semifinal game at state and we beat Hayward, but we lost 1-0 to Eau Claire Memorial in the championship game on a home run by a backup catcher that hadn't played all season. The regular catcher was injured earlier in the tournament. One lucky swing from a sub against our other pitcher, who ended up as an all-Big Ten college pitcher after graduation. What I learned from this experience was that all you can do is give it your best effort and be a team player. Nobody wins or is perfect all the time. If you give it your best shot and leave everything out there, that's all you can do. I experienced that fall from pride that is mentioned in Proverbs, but it taught me a valuable life lesson that if I fail or fall, I just get back up again and focus on putting my best effort forward. That is also carried to me into my Christian life. I am a sinner, and I know I'm not perfect. There's only one person that can claim that that's ever walked the face of the planet. One of my favorite verses is Proverbs 24:16. For though the righteous may fall 7 times, they rise again. How about falling 70 times or more in my case? But I really want to continue to become more like Christ every day and do my absolute best to follow God's will. He died for my sins and saved me with unwarranted grace. For that, I'm willing to dedicate my life to obey and serve him. One of our readings today was Paul's last letter in 2 Timothy, where he stated, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith." Note that he didn't glorify himself by saying, "I won the fight," or "I won the race." But he battled every day with all his heart to keep the faith and spread the gospel. And soon after, was executed by the Romans for the race he ran and the gospel message he spread to so many. Vince Lombardi once said, "Winning isn't everything, it's the only thing." Well, I changed that a little for our lives as believers. Jesus is everything. And he is the only thing that can give us true peace, joy, and salvation from our sins. Let us all finish the race and fight to give our Lord and Savior our best effort every day. Amen.
Our hymn of the day, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, ELW 631. Today we will sing verses 1, 3, and 4. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable.
Let us recite the Apostles' Creed found on page 12, and with the whole church, confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In gratitude and humility, let us join together in prayer on behalf of all of God's creation. Each petition will end with, Lord, in your mercy. Please respond with, hear our prayer. Inspire your church to love and serve all people. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Rescue families and nations torn apart by violence and warfare. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Comfort your people filled with anger or fear, anxiety or shame. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bring healing to all sick in mind, body, or spirit, especially those we now name before you, whether aloud or silently. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Make this congregation a community of humility and repentance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With grateful hearts, we commend our spoken and silent prayers to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to share the peace with your neighbor as you and your neighbor are comfortable. Lord's peace. Laura?
Yes.
Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. I got to go all the way down this line. It's a long line. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace to you. Lord's peace. Lots of little ones. Where's Deb? Lord's peace. Lord's peace, Joe. Lord's peace. I gotta get the mitts. Lord's peace.
How's our Tina doing?
Better.
The cold is starting.
Still ornery.
Yeah, good.
But she's
good.
Better. She can yell at me now. She can yell at me now. Lord's peace, Barb. Lord's peace. I can't hug you, otherwise I won't let go. So, Lord's peace. Jack, Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Judy, Lord's peace.
And I still do.
Peepers. Mary, Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Yeah, I know. You're going back and forth. So, Lord's peace to you.
I'm tired.
Well, have a seat. I'll come to you. It's okay. Lord's peace. Oh, Lord's peace to you. Lord's peace. Lord's peace. Lord's peace, Jackie. Lord's peace. Lord's peace to you both. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. Are you going to come up or do I need to come to you?
No, I'm coming up. She's coming in.
Very good. What a rowdy group. join me in the offertory prayer. God of all creation, all you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come to the Lord's banquet, for all is now ready, and all are welcome. Please be seated. Thank you. body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. The body of Christ given for you. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which you have now received, strengthen and keep you in his grace. Amen. Please join me in the prayer. We come again to you, O God, giving you thanks that in this feast of mercy you have embraced us and healed us, making us one in the body of Christ. Go with us on our way. Equip us for every good work, that we may continue to give you thanks by embracing others with mercy and healing, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our sending hymn today, Guide Me Ever Great Redeemer, ELW 618. Peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.